screenshot updated today, so I could be here with y'all, or I would have almost missed my opportunity.
Okay, okay.
So y'all know.
We're at a three. Dilate, she's, it faces to 80, she's at a minus two, and the water's broke.
So what's the abbreviation for the doctor breaking the water?
ME.
The procedure is, you're close, amniotomy. And then the acronym, it's, for instance, it's strong if it breaks on its own, spontaneous rupture of membrane. So if the doctor breaks it, there's another acronym. It's not spontaneous, but artificial rupture of membrane, and that's AROM. And then if it happens prematurely, we call it PROM. And if it's before you're in labor and premature, it's PPROM. So, rules.
And that will be on your level three ATI.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
And so you don't get to forget.
Yes.
Anything. Okay, sorry about that.
That's okay. That's perfect. I'm always,
I'm out of chair now.
I'm always ready for babies to come. I get excited and I want to run out there and check her myself and sit there and run a fit.
Hey, well, don't worry, you might not miss your chances.
Oh, yeah, thanks.
I'm glad somebody's watering.
You have the time that happened between your test exams that you have.
Yeah.
Do you have an induction schedule?
No, everything has to be.
Oh, well, then I will bring one of those hooks home.
Absolutely.
And then if Kelly can do it, I mean,
That's my passion. That's my you know, my true love. So, okay.
There you go. You get to go, girl.
20 years of L&D, so.
Yeah, we're good.
Oh, we're good.
Right here.
20 years.
Yeah, but you know, it's always the unforeseen that happens, if it's going to happen. Like, I had you really nice, neat, I stayed up here till midnight, made y'all nice little packets with holes and staples, because I was prepared, and then I came in this morning, and some of the information wasn't right, so I had to reprint it, and that's why you don't have staples, so.
Or holes.
Or holes punched in it, but.
Y'all are building resilience without those staples and holes. It's okay.
Right. Yeah, and the only reason I don't do these for my own class, just so you know, because we kill on trees, we put it up online.
Well, they do that.
Yeah, if they want to print them, they're welcome to. But for y'all, I did just so y'all could follow along a little bit easier. Oh, okay. Yeah, I'm saving trees. Amazon forest. So today we're going to talk about trees, and it's something that most of my career I've had to deal with the perinatal or the SIDS. I did do a few years inpatient pediatrics where we did some chronic kids and some oncology kids in a Navy hospital in San Diego, California, but I'm not going to admit to too much knowledge there because it's over 20 years and things change drastically. Some things are similar. I can't imagine the on-the-job training I got as a 22-year-old nurse giving methotrexate and other vincristine in somebody's little precious baby girl's portacath, and I just can't imagine what kind of on-the-job training it was. There were no certifications. It was just, this is how you do this. And when I think back now, what I had in my hands, it's really kind of overwhelming and frightening. I'm like, I can't believe this. Somebody would you know, now there's much more rigid parameters and training and, you know, stuff that you have to get certified, and thankfully. So, but grief, y'all will be studying with it, just because as nurses, lots of y'all have to deal with it with family or friends, but some people, maybe some of y'all that are younger may have not dealt with a whole lot of loss or grief, unless you grew up family members that have had things happen. As we get older, or certain families have a lot more grief than others, so it's something that you're going to kind of have to pay attention to, how you feel as you go into rooms and help families, help support them and help them grieve. you've got page numbers here for you to look at and reference in your book, but people have to think about whether this is real or perceived grief. There's different ways, psychological, biological, behavioral, how that it's going to impact your health. Remember, stress on anybody, too much stress increases your cortisol levels, impedes your health, your immune system. So we try to help our patients and families. So we support them through their grief process and encourage positive ways to grieve and not the maladaptive coping that we recognize. So remember, when you take our boards and our NCLEX questions, we're answering things and putting positives on what we can, promoting the best type of coping skills. So for grief processes, everybody is going to deal with it differently. You've probably seen people throw themselves down on a casket and cry, and then you've seen people that maybe you felt were aloof or isolated, or maybe didn't appear like they were caring, but you really don't know what's inside their head. So as nurses, we can't judge in a room. You know, you just support them all. There's no correct way. There's no timetable. It's certainly individualized, and our backgrounds, especially, you know, Erickson and our psychosocial backgrounds, are going to make a difference in how people grieve. Especially if they've seen other family members, you know, if that's how their family grieves, you're likely to latch on to the way your mother or your aunt or your sister has grieved. So Kubler-Ross studied stages of grief and did that for us. So, and has this order that they appear to go in, but they don't always go in this order, but the idea is that they could. Denial, anger, bargaining, depression, and then finally acceptance. So the idea is that they probably go through this order, but you know, every once in a while they'll kind of get backed up for whatever reason. I have a cute little clip on here that Ms. Christensen also has, and we actually play it in one of my classes as well when we study loss and grief in the LVN program. And it is a cute little giraffe that should help you. It'll be posted in your Canvas, so it should help you remember. There's actually two little versions of this, so if you
how you doing? They call me the barbecue boss man.
You have to be careful.
Some situations are plain embarrassing, but at the General, we'll cover you when others won't, even with a lapse of insurance.
Your eyebrows are missing.
Go to the General and save some time!
Okay, that's it. Go to the... There.
It's no big deal. It's probably not even quicksand. I'm gonna have a good laugh about this tonight with the guys. Well, this is just perfect. Quicksand, stupid jungle. I want to bite someone in the face. Mother. That stupid jungle. Are you there, God? It's me, Giraffe. Listen, if you would just give me a mulligan on this quicksand thing, I promise. No more peeing on your shorter creatures. What, you get a deal? Yeah, take me, sweet death. I await your loving embrace.
What?
I think I hit the bottom.
Hopefully that'll help you. Remember. Just be careful if you pull it up in front of people because there's two versions, like I said.
And that's one of them doesn't bleep it.
One of them doesn't bleep it.
Nurses don't say bad words.
Exactly.
So types of grief, y'all are going to need to understand that some of it's anticipatory. So it would be similar to what Ms. Christensen had to go through with her mom. Knowing that someone is going to pass or one of your children, that's anticipatory. Where you have time maybe to prepare and to cope. You have time to check into resources. Maybe you'll get hospice involved. You have more support from your community and your families. And we as nurses then are able to help with all those processes. It may help lessen the grieving process after your patient or your family member, their family member passes away, because of the stuff that we're able to offer to them up front and ways that we can help them respond and cope with terminal diagnoses or the stages of death. Disenfranchised grief, this would be something that I would say it's like getting cheated on grieving. The loss is not recognized maybe by society. Social supports may not be there. The individual might not ask for help because they're ashamed or they're afraid of how people are going to view them. So for examples of this, you know, when there's been a suicide in the family, for instance, if somebody's been married 10 times and their 10th marriage, maybe it was only a few years, that family may not recognize that person or that sister's marriage as being valid enough to have her grieve, but to her, it's a huge loss. Whether it's the first or the 10th, but that's kind of an example of a disenfranchised type of grief. So that individual that's been married 10 times, she may truly be struggling and grieving, and yet she feels ashamed to ask for help or support. Other ones are an ex-spouse. So just because you got a divorce from someone doesn't mean they're not necessarily in your heart. I mean, sometimes yes, sometimes no, right? And sometimes people that you lose that maybe you were never married to, that was just a partner or a friend, or, you know, people feel cheated when they die because they don't get the same support from society or friends. Even your job might not recognize someone you lived with as being something that you get off for. Other ones are people who have been through abortions. They may not. That's a disenfranchised type of grief. So affairs, same thing. Those are all things that could be disenfranchising, and those people would feel cheated, right? A complicated grief is what it sounds like. I'm not going to read all those to you individually, but understand that it'd be very similar to having your mother die, having a child get in the hospital, having your house have needs to take care of, things that kind of go wrong all at the same time. You don't get the time that you need, especially if you're working a full-time job, to sit down and just, you know, really truly grieve. It can be a grief that can be seen as complicated when it lasts for more than 6 months without any sign of hope that it's going to resolve. These people could see auditory or visual hallucinations, meaning they may feel like, or they may hear statements in an NCLEX question that seems like, I feel like he's going to come look through my window any minute. I feel like he's just right out there in the yard. I would see that as a type of complicated grief. They're not coping well. They're not adapting and moving forward. They're just seeing or hearing things. They're hearing their loved ones. When they make almost suicidal ideations, like life seems so empty now, or I just wish this would end, or I wish I could go be with them. Sometimes those are signs of a complicated type of grief, where they're just not moving forward. Interventions as nurses that we're going to help, we're going to suggest psychotherapy, encourage that. Encourage them to see a grief counselor or just a therapist. Of course, we're always going to monitor for those scary statements like, I wish I could just go be with them, life seems so empty, those kind of things. And assessing for a secondary problem, such as an alcohol or drug abuse issue. So how many times have y'all known people were, obviously people use alcohol in inappropriate ways, but after somebody dies, it can get really heavy for a lot. Those boxes of wine or boxes of cases of beer that you see piled up on their steps may be an indication that they're not breathing well, and you may need to go step in as a friend or a caregiver and try to get them therapy before they go down the wrong path. Children. Now, children, how they respond to the grief is going to be different based on their age and, like, Piaget's cognitive levels, if y'all remember those somewhat. You're going to look at younger children as thinking that death is reversible, and they think somebody can just wake up. I was recently at my brother-in-law's funeral. He died of a brain tumor, and my little nephew's only three, and my sister decided to let him be right there for an open casket, and he kept saying that, "Wake up, Daddy, wake up, Daddy." And it's like, you know, breaks your heart. And so, and he still remembers that because that's what he'll bring up in conversations. "Daddy, you wake up, Daddy, wake up," you know, things like that. So when they're little, they don't truly understand. I don't know that I would have chosen that path for a young child, but again, that's an individualized thing, and that's how she chose to deal with it. She needed to let him see that. As they're older, they start to view death as more of a permanent thing, and they realize that they're not coming back, the school-age children, I would say. And children need to time also to talk to someone. It's great if you can use therapeutic play, draw pictures, show me how you're feeling today. Can you draw people in your family? They may draw somebody up in heaven on a cloud. That gives you an opportunity to talk to them about that. Grieving children are going to feel less alone when they're with other children. So there's great support systems out there. One of them that I'm familiar with is called Inheritance of Hope. So it's a great resource if you need to write that down. If you ever have a family member with a terminal illness, and they're looking at parents in this case. So similar to the trips, what is that, Make-A-Wish that kids can sometimes take when a child has a terminal illness, if it's a parent that has a terminal illness, it's an organization called Inheritance of Hope. They get a lot of private funding, private donors. One of them is, who makes all the fancy jewelry in Texas now, the lady. Krista Scott?
Kendra
Scott, that's her name. I knew I couldn't think of those on the tip of my tongue. She's a huge fundraiser for that. And so she donates lots of money for that, and then it's not based on income or anything else. It's just based on if you have a parent that's dying, you turn in paperwork and a doctor's note that's saying you're terminal, and they'll take you on a trip. My sister and her husband went to North Carolina and stayed at the Biltmore Mansion, I think it's called, and they got to do river rafting. So that all depends on how well that person is. They have other opportunities, and they brought grief counselors for every age group of child that they would meet one-on-one with the child. They'd meet one-on-one with each spouse. They also were the only people that were able to get her husband to write letters. He's very stubborn, and he thought, even though he had a brain tumor, that he wasn't going to die. He was kind of in denial. He was also an oncologist and a marathon runner. Never smoked a day in his life, never drank a day in his life, or I won't say a day. But he never smoked or drank. He didn't eat meat. He took care of himself, and even at the age of 60, he was running and winning marathons in his. So for him to be in denial like that, he kind of refused to acknowledge it, and it was very hard on my sister to be able to grieve or deal with the death or anything ahead of time, because he wouldn't acknowledge it. So these grief counselors kind of force you and help talk them into writing letters. That's their specialty, and they made videos for all the family, for all the children, so that they could look back on these videos and have a message from their dad. And you can see how imperative that might be in the grieving process someday, or to have those to look back at. So I encourage you all to ever use that resource to give to patients and families, because it's one of the most invaluable things my sister has been left with since he died, which was just like a month ago. That is the one thing that she really clings to, was the trip, the pictures, the videos he left, has really helped that organization to be there for her when everybody else is far away. Allowing children to say goodbye and explaining to a person that is dying that, you know, it's okay to go say goodbye to your grandma. Yes, she may not answer you, but remember, y'all may have been told this before, hearing is the last symptom to, or the last sensory, sorry, the last sensory thing to lose. So they may not be able to respond, maybe they've had a major stroke and a brain bleed, but hearing is your last sense. So it's okay to encourage children to go and say goodbye and tell them that their grandma may be able to hear them. Greeting older adults is, again, going to depend on what their background's like, what their life has been like. But it can present as anger, sadness, depression, especially, and then furthermore go into a secondary depression. They may neglect their own needs. They may not drink. Then they get dehydrated. Then what happens when older people get dehydrated? They act kind of crazy, right? Remember? They may get dehydrated, they may end up in the ER, they may not even be meeting their basic hygiene or eating. So they'll lack the support system if it was a spouse that they once had, and so that makes it that much more difficult. For perinatal grief, we look at often people, anyone who's had a pregnancy and been told something that's not right about their baby. Everybody wants your baby to be perfect and you want everything to go well. So if you're told, or you can imagine if a woman is told or a family is told that there may be something wrong, and they're usually not real good with delivery. If you've ever been watchful in those situations, sometimes it's a sonotech, sometimes it's a doctor or a nurse, and they might not mean poorly by it, but they might do an ultrasound and say something like, the head looks really enlarged right now, for shouldn't be this big, or there's a lot of fluid in there, and they always like clicking and stuff, and so that raises your anxiety already. And then there's a lot of false positives as well. When they look at sonograms, many people are sent to Dallas or here in Tyler for a higher level sonogram because of things that they see, and so that raises your anxiety. So when you're actually told maybe that there's a defect, maybe that the baby has a club foot or a congenital heart defect that they can see on the sonograms, you will start to grieve already for the loss of the baby that's not perfect. And wondering when that baby is born, what kind of life that baby's gonna have, and what kind of circumstances you'll have. Will the mother be able to work? Can she hold a full-time job, or is she gonna be home with the child? They may not have good support systems, so just imagining them not being able to work would be a huge disaster. They may certainly grieve about the mental picture they have in their mind. So this prenatal diagnosis is just amazing that they can do now. They can do preconception and pre-implantation both diagnosis. So if you have had a loss, a fetal demise, and the doctors told you, well, there was a genetic issue, or you have it in your family, or maybe you know you're a carrier for something already and it runs in your family. These are not choices that people can make. A lot of it is still very expensive, but the prices are going to come down year after year after year. And they can look at things ahead of time. I don't think they do this here in Tyler, I kind of doubt it, but they may be able to do simple blood draw, certainly, for your quad screen. They can send that off, and we do that anyway. We offer that to parents. So if you're familiar with that, when they check for certain proteins in your blood, and they can tell you that, oh, you have a marker, your child could be at risk for having this genetic syndrome or chromosome anomaly, and then sometimes you'll have to go in and get an amniocentesis. So a lot of those are false positives, y'all might have heard, with the blood draws. And that's scary while you're waiting for that period of time. Plus, amniocentesis is not without risk. You know, you could poke things in there. You could break your fluid. You can cause an eruption. Certainly, you could poke the baby. So a lot of people will, I've noticed a lot of nurses, too, declining to get quad screen done, or they don't want to know ahead of time because then there's a lot of worrying. And that's just kind of a personal choice. I think it's certainly a lot of labor and delivery nurses, at least we know, choose to decline our quad screens because we didn't want to either worry about the future, worry about false positives. But that, again, is a personal choice because a lot of people would rather be prepared and have the resources set up and know that, okay, my baby's going to need to be born in Dallas where there's this great, you know, NICU, and they're specialized in left-sided hypoplastic heart. So that's a personal choice. Things that are now available for prenatal diagnoses are certain congenital malformations, chromosomal disorders like, name one for me because I'm not thinking of one.
Chromosomal?
Down syndrome, trisomy 21, 18.
23,
absolutely. And then some of these single cell gene disorders and metabolic disorders, they can look at that ahead of time. So if you have some of this in your family, myotonic dystrophy or something, these are great options out there for people to choose to look between. It's the maternal blood usually can be analyzed for the abnormal alpha fetal proteins. That's basically part of your quad screen. And I just put a link on there. You can look at some of the places in Dallas and what we look at. For us to support these families, we have to be able to know what developmental stage they're in. We have to be able to kind of assess what their coping style is, what their resources are, and some possible nursing diagnoses are there, ineffective coping or interrupted family processes. Planning, we gotta help our patients plan for, again, are they gonna have to go to Dallas? Are they gonna have to stay in a motel or a Ronald McDonald home? What kind of resources are out there ahead of time for families that know that they're gonna have a child born with a major congenital defect? We're gonna help when a baby's born, especially that, you know, lots of babies pop in on us in labor and delivery. I always joke around that we're supposed to be a low risk, level one nursery, but we get what we get. We get what comes in the door. We don't get to pick. And so sometimes babies are born with us that have chromosomal anomalies, or their tiny contents are born on the outside, or they'll have a congenital defect in their back, like spina bifida, which NCLEX question, what kind of nutritional supplement do women need to take to prevent those things?
Yes.
Absolutely. Good. I just like to throw those little OB NCLEX questions in when I can. But so those, when those babies are born, you know, what do you think mom's face and dad's face is going to look like when you pull out a baby that doesn't look like what they expected? And let me tell you, clumpy, not such a big deal at all, because lots of babies have telepies and their feet are turned in. But try, if you've ever seen a cleft lip that is so big and so bad that it just flanges open. If you ever go on Google and look at images for some of these cleft lips, very repairable, right? In stages. But to hand and pull a mom that wasn't expecting that and hand her a baby, you have to kind of be prepared with the right things to say, because y'all, we love these NCLEX questions with all the cliche things. So you can imagine what would be the wrong thing to say. What are the cliche things that people might be guilty of saying?
It's
gonna
be
just fine. Oh my God.
Don't worry.
You can try again. I mean, obviously that's not one that people would say, but you need to really be there for them and listen, and silence is golden. I've noticed before when I'm about to panic about what I'm going to say, I don't say anything, because it's better just to be quiet than to let the wrong thing come out of your mouth. And so silence works for a lot of things. When you think, I learned it from one of the doctors one time. We were always calling him about orders in the middle of the night, and we'd say all these things, and we'd just get silenced. And we would say, you know, Dr. So-and-so, trying to wake him up. We thought he was asleep, and he goes, I'm thinking. I thought, smart man. Instead of just spouting all the orders, he's sitting there quietly listening. So that's physician, and the child will get a referral. You're going to facilitate touching and holding, because they might not be comfortable, they may be afraid to hurt the baby. So, you know, wrap them up, unwrap them, put them in their arms, help them, hold them, listen and be present. Focus on something that's really positive too. You say, oh wow, you know, your baby's eyes are so pretty. Is that, does she get that from you or your husband? You know, who do you think she looks like more with the eyes? Something like positive, remembering those NCLEX questions. Using effective therapeutic communication, and sometimes that's just the NCLEX question. It's like, I'm here for you if you need me. Remember those? Obviously, the wrong answers are the ones where you're trying to escape the room, where you're not comfortable. You're looking to make them comfortable. So just being there for them at the bedside. Emphasizing any child's abilities, community resources, but just being there for them is always the best answer, right? With perinatal loss, certainly people that have risk factors for this are people with either poor prenatal care, no prenatal care, people that were women over 40 at conception, because our eggs were born with all the eggs we'll ever have and they get older. People with diabetic moms are huge risks, high risks. Thyroid disease, lupus is another one that is kind of scary. Smoking. Women in domestic violence situations, and y'all would be surprised how many. Lots of falls that come in repetitively. I say falls, you know, lots of falls that were really kicks in the belly, all kinds of stuff like that. So those are going to be high risk for either an early loss, a fetal demise, and remember, a baby's not viable until how many weeks? Can a baby live outside the NICU? Outside the mommy's tummy? Well, officially in your textbook it probably says 20 weeks, but that is very rare. So we look at when do most NICUs take a baby is 23, 24 weeks, and that's skirting down all the time. But officially in the textbooks, because one baby somewhere in the world survived at 20 weeks, they actually call that gestational age 20 weeks. But yeah, you won't see them that small in the NICU. But so we call fetal demise any baby that made it past 20 weeks, and before that we call them a missed AB or a miscarriage or abortion, just spontaneously in the medical terms. But honestly, we don't come in and tell our patients, hey, you're only 19 weeks, so you didn't have a fetal demise, you had a miscarriage. You know, we go in and we just treat them all the same, comfort them the same, no matter how, because maybe they waited for a long time to have that baby. Maybe they were only 8 weeks, but they were super excited and tried 4 years, you know? So you just can't ever tell. We always offer them a private room, even if it has to be on another floor. Sometimes they don't want to be near the nursery and they don't want their babies crying. So we offer them a room down the hallway. Sometimes they want to be, but for NCLEX, you might be looking for a word like that. Offer them a room away from the nurse's station or away from the other babies. We're gonna encourage them to ask lots of questions. This is a nice little video that shows how some moms deal with
it. You gotta end the show.
What's
right,
that?
Right click and end your show. Right, no, get off of that.
Oh.
And right click and end your show.
Is this the one side? Like that?
Okay, now find the rest. Slide.
I got it right there.
Yeah, okay.
Thank you.
lock of hair, so you just measure them and give them measurements and fold them in a blanket that they can take home as blanket, you know, because they help their baby. And we'll talk more about that after a break.
What time should the